Hello, and welcome back to another video in my OFDM video series. In this video, I will manually optimize the settings of the signal generator and spectrum analyzer. I'm starting with the waveform that we used in the CP-OFDM basics video, and I've increased the frequency to 40 GHz and dropped the power level to negative 30 dBm. As a result, we can see that the EVM is degraded to negative 26 dB, and the constellation is pretty fuzzy. Let's see how much more performance we can get out of this instrument just by optimizing the settings of our test equipment. So go to the signal generator, go to the home screen, go to IQ Modulator, and check the Optimize EVM checkbox. Alternatively, we could click the Adjust IQ Modulator to Current Frequency button. Either one will perform an on-the-fly calibration of the IQ Modulator at the current frequency, correcting for carrier leakage and IQ imbalance and quadrature. Let's jump over to the Spectrum Analyzer. So first, I want to enable an equalizer, so we'll go to Sync, Demod, Tracking. You can see right now we're using an equalizer, that's this parameter estimation, that's only using the pilot information to be able to build that equalizer. And that channel compensation here, you can see how that's turned on. So let's switch that to using pilot and data aided. And this will improve the EVM, but at the moment, see that negative 26 dB EVM, we toggle this off and actually see that it's not improving the EVM at all. I mean, that's because there's another phenomenon that's limiting our performance, and it's not the channel flatness. So what is that? Well, on this magnitude capture window, we have a hint. The reference level is sitting up here at negative at 0 dBm, and the peak signal level is down here at negative 25 dBm or so. So we're actually underdriving the signal analyzer by about 25 dB, and we've lost that much dynamic range of the instrument. We're significantly underdriving it. So let's drop the reference level to negative 25 dBm, and immediately we can see that the EVM is improved to negative 35 dB. If we go back to the equalizer that we had in the previous step, if we toggle that equalizer off, we can see that the EVM has changed to negative 32 dB. So actually, the channel flatness is about on the same order of magnitude as negative 35 dB for the EVM. All right, so what else? Well, we could do a little bit more than just changing the reference level. There's a few other things if we understand how a spectrum analyzer acquires a signal. So let's go to amplitude scale, amplitude config, and we have three settings here. We have the reference level, we have the preamplifier, and we have the attenuator. So normally the attenuator is coupled to the reference level, and the preamplifier will turn that on manually or via the auto level. But I'm going to set all these to manual control. So with the reference level at negative 25 dBm, I'm going to adjust the front end attenuation in multiple steps until I see the best EVM possible. And then once I've achieved that, then I'm going to change the reference level in 1 dB increments until I have the optimal EVM. And I'm going to repeat that process for every preamplifier state that I have. In this case here, it's just on or off, but some instruments will have a 0 dB, 15 dB, and 30 dB gain state. All right, so with the preamp off, we'll change the attenuation to 5 dB, 10 dB, 15 dB. We can see this only degrades the performance. So we get the best performance at 0 dB attenuation, and then we'll drop this reference level. So let's drop this in 1 dB increments. We can see the EVM actually hasn't really changed much. It's still at negative 35 dB. Let's go ahead and drop that reference level all the way down to negative 60 dBm, and we can see the EVM is still at negative 35 dB. Well, we're not actually overdriving the analyzer. What's actually happened is we've maxed out the IF gain on the IF amplifiers inside of the spectrum analyzer. And so we're not going to get any further improvement in the EVM by reducing the reference level. We've already minimized the attenuation. All right, so we know that negative 35 dB is the best EVM that we can get with the preamplifier off. Well, how about we turn that preamplifier on? We're going to increase the reference level back to negative 25 dBm, turn the preamplifier on, and immediately you can see we have an IF overload condition here. So I'm going to increase this attenuation. Let's set that to 30 dB attenuation. And I'm going to walk this attenuation down until I get a similar EVM performance as before. So walk this down in 5 dB increments. At negative 33 dB, negative 37. So we're already better EVM with the preamplifier engaged. Let's drop this down another 5 dB. And now it's about negative 38 dB EVM. If I drop down to zero, it's like it's about negative 37 dB. So I think we had about the best performance here at 5 dB attenuation. All right, the next step is going to be searching through the reference levels. So I'm going to drop this in 1 dB increments. Okay, and we can see the EVM has gotten significantly worse. So this is the left edge of the bathtub curve. Let's go ahead and increase that reference level. Negative 29. We can see the EVM is actually pretty flat over this range here. So it doesn't matter too much what we set that reference level to. It seems like we have a floor of around negative 40 dB EVM, negative 39 dB EVM. All right, so we've maxed this one out at negative 25 dBm. And that's just based on the preamplifier and the attenuation trying to avoid overdriving the instrument. So let's just change that to the max value here, negative 25. While I was doing that, you may have noticed that there was an IF overload warning in the lower left-hand corner of the spectrum analyzer. That IF overload message appears as soon as one bit of the ADC inside the analyzer is clipped. And especially when using signals with high crest factors, like OFDM, it may be beneficial to slightly clip the ADC, since most of the signal is located at lower power levels. Therefore, the ADC is optimized for the majority of samples. All right, so what else can we optimize here? I think this is the best performance we're going to achieve, but it might be helpful to do a little bit of debugging in case if we don't actually achieve the best EVM, if we want to understand if there's maybe a little bit more performance left on the table. So let's open up display config, and I'll go to channel flatness. And I'll also take a look at group delay. Right, and I can see the channel flatness. Looks like it's a couple tenths of a dB across this 15 to 20 meg wide channel. And the group delay looks like it's a couple of nanoseconds peak to peak. That's pretty darn flat. But in this case here, it could be flatter, and that's what the equalizer is doing for us. It's compensating for the flatness of the channel. All right, what other displays could I take a look at? Well, we have EVM versus symbol and carrier, and we can take a look at that just in the vertical or horizontal slice. And we have the corresponding power versus symbol and carrier. So if I zoom in on the EVM versus symbol and carrier, it looks like there's no particular pattern of where the EVM is high and where the EVM is low. And that's just because this signal is dominated by a random noise process, and that's what's limiting our EVM. But the full scale here for a couple of these symbols, the worst case looks like it's about negative 30 dB EVM, whereas a lot of the signals, the symbols are down at negative 50. Just depends from frame to frame and acquisition to acquisition what the EVM is going to be. Likewise, if I take a look at the power here, I don't see any lines, I don't see any particular patterns within the data transmission that's telling me that there's some issue with the signal. But what happens if there was? So I jump over to the signal generator, go to this AWGN block, I could add in a CW interferer, and the carrier to interferer ratio, I'll set that to 30 dB, and turn that on. And there's a very faint line that I can see in the middle here. And that means that the DC subcarrier looks like it has a little bit more power all the time compared to the rest of the symbols here. And if I jump over to the EVM versus symbol and carrier, I can see very clearly that there's a high EVM at that DC subcarrier. In fact, this is so common that there's a lot of wireless standards that intentionally do not use the DC subcarrier because they know that IQ modulators are going to have RF leakage that causes poor performance on that carrier. I can also see that on the EVM versus carrier graph in case if it's difficult to spot on the color graph. So here I have a very high EVM. In fact, here it looks like that EVM is approaching about negative 15 dB or so. And that EVM is constant over time. Whereas if I were to change that interferer from being a CW interferer to a pulsed interferer, I might see that EVM get worse for some symbols and then better for others. I could also try adding additive noise to this, in which case this is going to apply to all of the subcarriers equally. And I don't see a particular pattern here, it's just overall the EVM has gotten worse. One last thing that I can do, and I've saved this one for last because for a lot of the signals that we're analyzing, it takes a little bit of time to process in the frame. I just happen to pick a frame structure here that is pretty short. And so if I change my capture time here, let's increase that by an order of magnitude to 500 microseconds, and I set the result range number of frames to analyze to 10. Now, rather than analyzing just the first frame in this acquisition, I'm analyzing the first 10 frames. And now I have some statistics. So over those 10 frames that I captured, the EVM is varying between, let's just do a run single here so we can catch a single number, negative 30.5 and negative 30.0. So the variation is pretty compact. If I turn off this interferer, we should get back to the negative 40 dB EVM performance or so. So this is the range that EVM is varying over. Likewise, I can see that the power is varying very little. It's a very consistent power, and the crest factor is about the same as well. But for every single measurement that I have on here, there's always some uncertainty. And that's true for every measurement that you make. There will always be uncertainty. So don't fret over the last 100th or 1,000th of a dB. Sometimes don't even worry about the last 10th of a dB. In this case here, it looks like we have an uncertainty that's somewhere on the order of about, 7/10 of a dB. All right, that's a quick primer into how to analyze your OFDM signal and optimize the settings of both the signal generator and the spectrum analyzer to get the best performance you can at the current frequency and power level. In the next video, I'll show how to optimize this setup because, agreeably, it was maybe a little painful to search through all these settings here. So that's a great job for a computer to do, and in fact, we can do that calibration ahead of time so that when we're testing our device under test, it's just a quick lookup table and it's super fast. All right, I'll see you in the next one, guys. Bye for now.